Okay, well, good afternoon. Really exciting to see such a great crowd and interest in the different things we have going on in our products. And we're going to highlight for you some of the details that we saw from Tony's presentation a few moments ago, and even a few details from Martin's presentation of just immediately preceding this one. So we're going to highlight some of the realizing the digital twin and discuss what goes into realizing the digital twin. Now, just for a moment, the CTO role, as we heard just a moment ago, is around things like alignment of our technologies and helping the different segments and our contribution to that to help foster innovation, really help to collaborate with other Siemens companies and be able to build products upon the PL solutions that we're also fond of here. But really part of what we're trying to do is bring to life the cross-product integration and deliverables that we have. And so I'm going to introduce the next piece with a clip of some of the functions that we're going to be seeing in our presentation. Guest speaker there at the end of the video clip, who's going to join me on stage here in just a moment, is Alan Klapmeier. So Alan, if you wouldn't mind joining me up here. Alan is the CEO of One Aviation, founder of Cirrus Aircraft, and co-founder of Kestrel Aircraft as well. So Alan, thank you for joining us. Welcome to the stage, and
thank you.
Appreciate your participation with us.
So the last little bit you saw there was an Eclipse VLJ, a very light jet, and yes, it is absolutely as cool as it looks. I am an airplane nut. From longer than I can remember, I've been in love with airplanes. I learned to fly in high school. I started the design of what became the first Cirrus in 1979 in a boring accounting class, I should add. But in addition to being someone that's just in love with all of the aspects of general aviation, what I've really become is someone that's in love with the value of general aviation and how do we bring that to more people? How do we change it? It's an example you'll see a lot of as we go through this next part of the presentation, because aviation and something like the Eclipse jet is so ideally suited to this change in the world that you see in this kind of technology. From an airplane point of view, people think of it, and I know some of you out here are work in aviation. Just out of curiosity, how many are pilots? That's not nearly enough. I always tell people there's only two answers to that question of are you a pilot? And the answer is yes or not yet. So I'll assume there's a whole bunch of not yets here. But aviation is an industry that has been very, very slow to develop. It's thought of as high tech, but really it's been stuck in the 50s. And from a general aviation point of view, a lot of the airplanes from the 1950s are still in production. What we've seen now is this gradual push towards differentiation, towards customer value, to how do we build a better product, and how do we build a better product faster. Everything that you're going to see now is about how we do that. Some of it's how we've done that, more of it's how we do it in the future. And so there's just a lot of really cool things going on. The digital twin concept matches what we do in aviation and what we do from an FAA certification process. How do we develop, design, certify, manufacture, support? So it's a lot of cool stuff, and I appreciate being here.
Yeah, great. Well, thank you so much, Alan. And just to give the audience a guide as to how we're going to walk through our presentation today, we're going to start with a short introduction, and then we're going to deep dive into some of the topics that we heard from Tony a few moments ago around ideation and smart products, a realization around smart factories, and utilization and gaining real in-service product performance information as the product is in service. So we're going to be focusing on those topics as we dive in. And I think, you know, really the whole idea around digital twins and how those provide values to companies around things like predicting reality, behind helping understand the outcomes of the operation of the equipment or vehicle, and really indicating those companies that are actually working to drive themselves to a digital enterprise.
So this is about design iteration first. How do we iterate designs faster to get to safe utility? How do we get to safe utility? How do we get to value? And then, of course, how do we do that in production where we drive costs down so that more of you will learn to fly? And then how do we do that feedback loop? How do we make sure that we're in the position to do the next better product? I was teasing Martin about the box. Yep, how do we build the next better box? That's what we do.
All right, so as many of our companies already today are building smarter products and smart, you know, and utilizing technology to help them build smart factories, things like autonomous vehicles and machine learning and building autonomous factories that can really operate themselves. I think some of you have seen the example that we have in our Omberg plant where we build our PLCs and small switch gears, and there it's a fully automated factory environment that allows customization of individual products that are really quite small. This idea of building in that autonomous machine behavior and the ability to extend factories to operate on their own. And then finally, big data and performance information coming back. We heard from Tony's presentation of wouldn't it be nice if we were able to take some vibration information, typically would be described as a displacement function over time, and be able to integrate that and understand exactly what kinds of load conditions are going to be caused by that, what kinds of fatigue conditions might be caused, and then ultimately making product adjustments and changes based on that real-time information. So, you know, as we saw with Tony, we are really focusing on things around how products are brought to life, how the ideation process is enhanced with some of the technologies that were described earlier with generative design, intelligent models, how things are realized in additive manufacturing and advanced robotics, and finally, how we utilize this information in in-service product lifecycle. And really, the presentation that we're going to deep dive into is going to focus on each of those three topics. But these digital twins are alive and well, really, at One Aviation, Alan. And I thought it would be helpful for you to describe some of the ways that you're incorporating these into your operation.
Yep. I'd say not only alive and well, but alive and necessary. One of the things that people often hear about as a barrier to entry, a constraint, a reason why the industry doesn't doesn't change faster, is FAA certification. And of course, that's generally an excuse that people have, but here's the kernel of reality about it. The FAA does not certify airplanes. The FAA certifies documents. The FAA certifies a package of data that says this data, this stack of paper, is what we certify. Now, you prove that every airplane looks like that. And so I love this concept of the digital twin. It's something that you roll around in your mind and you think, yeah, boy, this fits the FAA model perfectly. So what we design is actually the digital twin. And then our job is to track the production, the conformity. Does it match the design? The reality in use, does it match the design? So it really is how we do things.
And really, in a way, how you bring those technologies together and hand them off across these different domains and processes that you have to maintain.
From engineering, where NX into team center and how the airplane is produced, everything is about conformity, everything is about documentation, and how we use that data through the entire life cycle of the product. One of the things that some of you have heard about probably as production changes, and then trying to manage that in a regulated FAA environment, is the idea of counterfeits. How do you know that the parts in the airplane actually are the parts that were approved by the FAA? So again, it's data tracking, and to a gigantic database. Every nut, every bolt, every rivet, every part, what's the conformity, what's the history, what's the design, what's the use, what airplane did it go into?
Okay, so some of the things that we see our customers involved with and helping them solve some of the things around things like the product twin and how the products will look and fit, what their performance characteristics are, what they need to be, are the performance requirements being met, can we validate those up front, how to define how the factory might be laid out, what the robot functions are, the attributes of those robots, and then ultimately how we feedback information from the in-service products and gaining insight to how they're performing, helping identify predictive maintenance characteristics, and being actually able to validate that these products are performing as designed or not. And if they're not, then how do we make adjustments for
right.
that?
And performance from an aviation point of view, from an aviation business point of view, obviously is all encompassing. It's how do we design things on time? How do we build them on time? How do we track the production time? How do we track that the part then is built accurately? And when it comes to performance, in the end, if it's not accurate from a shape point of view, the airplane doesn't perform the way it's supposed to. So all of this goes back and forth between the digital model and reality. As this clicks through, this is a great graphic and one of the things that I really enjoy about the building of the airplane. Again, it is the life cycle of the design, the conception, and how do you get to the final airplane. And then the next, which is how do you then do product improvement. This is what we call Project Canada right now. It is the next derivative of the Eclipse. It's only a couple little changes. It's a bigger wing, bigger engines, bigger fuselage, bigger fuel tank, higher payload, different electrical system, different wire harness. But in fact, those are really little things if what you've got is the digital model to start with. So when we talk to customers, to competitors, to the FAA, to suppliers, they go, oh my gosh, you're changing everything. Well, I forgot to add a bigger tail. No, they really are little changes. It's 2 feet per wing. We've got the model. It's the wire harness is a different box and 14 inches longer because the fuselage is 14 inches longer. But when you've got all of the data captured in a system this powerful, it really is relatively small. And then when you look at what the predictive capabilities, the analytic capabilities, we're trying to, when we talk about FAA certification, it's about design, analysis, and substantiation. Well, substantiation is the test, and the better your analysis, the less you have to spend time and money on test. So all of this is what these kinds of systems allow, is us to iterate faster, come up with the next differentiated design that improves the value for the customer, and it's obviously necessary for the company. I can't wait.
Well, that's
for that
awesome.
Airplane.
And we saw in Tony's presentation a little bit about a walk around the different product sets that really support the digital enterprise software that we deliver to market. And these are tools that help enable the digital twins. And this view is just a bit more detailed view of that, looking at the different products that support these different processes, whether it's in product design with our NX or Solid Edge products, in our performance analytics that we saw a little bit about already with Omnio and some of our Mind apps, predictive analytics and some of the work that our SimCenter team is driving all the way through our manufacturing. But the key to this is enabling information to flow smoothly across these different applications, be able to share product information, be able to share that with the performance team, 1D simulation, 3D simulation, all the way down onto the shop floor manufacturing execution. And that's enabled through our
process and cycle it back.
That's right.
And back and forth.
So we're going to be walking through that with today's journey. We're going to get started with the ideation phase. And with that, I would like to welcome additional members of our team to the stage: Paul Brown, Bill Lewis, Paul Bevan, Ron P., and Ganesh Sethuraman.